Hello, hello, and welcome again to a Beatles program that we call Things We Said Today. This is a weekly show in which we talk about what's going on in the news with the Beatles. I'm Ken Michaels, one of the co-hosts, known for my other Beatles program called Every Little Thing, being joined by my co-host, the man on the West Coast, Mr. San Francisco himself, that being Steve Marinucci of Beatles Examiner fame. Hi, Steve.
Hi, Ken. Mr. San Francisco, I'm not even there.
Well, you're close to San Francisco.
I am close to it. I'm closer than you. Let's put it that way.
Australia okay. is closer to me.
I'm closer than you are to San Francisco, but anyway, whatever. All right.
So on today's show, I thought we'd talk about two particular topics. And one of them is something that I think only broke news-wise either today or yesterday.
It was yesterday.
And it's a brand new EP. It's a digital download, and it's free from iTunes. And it's called Four. And actually, the full title is Four, John, Paul, George, and Ringo. And it's one song each from the Beatles as solo artists. And I found this really interesting. The four songs, by the way, from John, you've got Love from the Plastic Ono Band album. From Paul, you got Call Me Back Again from the Wings album Venus and Mars. From George, you got Let It Down from All Things Must Pass. And from Ringo, Walk With You, his duet with Paul that's on the Why Not album. So we have these four songs available for free all of a sudden. And this was a nice surprise. Really, really surprised me. I certainly wasn't expecting anything like this to come out. And just want to know, first of all, our thoughts, both of our thoughts, on something like this coming out and the fact that it's free. Steve?
I downloaded it this morning. I was tied up yesterday, so I didn't really get to do it. But I listened to it today, and it sounds great. I like the fact that there's a couple of what you could call deep tunes. I don't know that Love is particularly deep, but Call Me Back Again is kind of deep. And Walk With You that was great. I'm sure they all had, they all had their reasons for picking the songs. I'd love to know what each of them were. You can guess that Call Me Back Again was because, Paul's reissuing Venus and Mars and give himself a little plug on that and Let It Down from All Things Must Pass. Goes along with the issue of the George Harrison box set. Walk With You is a great pick just because it's a great song, and mm-hmm. of course it's got the two of them on there. Love is a classic chestnut, and I'm gonna guess that Yoko is a little sentimental, getting a little sentimental there, with that one. That's the reason why she picked that one, and it's also a great song too.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, I would love to know the exact reason why they picked each one. But I think it's great. And somebody on Facebook wondered if maybe this is in advance of an album of the four of them separately like that. And that's an interesting thought. I'm not sure that they would. I can imagine them dividing, figuring out how the royalties would be divided and. Going and that kind of thing. And I kind of don't see that happening, but maybe it will. That would be interesting.
Wow.
What do you think?
Well, first of all, I love the fact that this was done. I don't know why these four songs were chosen. And I don't know. It never even dawned on me, really, that Call Me Back Again, because it's from Venus and Mars, which is about to come out, the remaster in November, and Let It Down, which is also a very deep cut, albeit from a very popular album.
Mm-hmm.
You never hear Let It Down being played on the radio.
I'll give you. It's a song that I've always really liked and listened to a lot. So, but yeah, I suppose.
But in terms of radio airplay, these are all deep cuts. I mean, Love has gotten decent airplay through the years, but not the kind of airplay that a hit single would have.
Okay.
It was an album cut, and it really intrigues me, these four songs, why they were chosen. I don't really think it's because of, the Harrison box and Venus and Mars, why the George and the Paul were chosen that way. But the whole thing, what's far more important than all this,
mm-hmm.
is packaging the four solo Beatles together for anything. And this has never been done before.
Right.
I mean,
yeah,
that
is definitely a first.
Yeah. I remember being surprised when something like The Best of George Harrison came out and they mixed the Beatles with the solo George there. And that even was repeated later on with the Imagine John Lennon soundtrack,
mm-hmm.
which was released really as a John Lennon album, albeit a soundtrack, but it had Beatles recordings and solo John together. But
yeah.
You've never seen any kind of a package where you've got all four of them
and
put together where it's just the four of them.
Mm-hmm. There have been bootlegs that have done this kind of thing.
Well, that's bootlegs.
You're right about a legitimate release.
Yeah. But, I mean, the whole idea of packaging the four of them individually where they have had their own careers and have had success, each of them on their own, and just because of the fact that they were once in the biggest band of all time, putting the four of them together, is it a good idea to put out packages later on of any kind of collection, be it an EP of four songs or a full album's worth, and packaging them in such a way that it's the Beatles, it's a continuation of the Beatles?
I think you have to say it is, for the simple reason that, number one, it hasn't been done before. It's different, and it's not something, I mean, people are always saying, you know, with good reason, that all we get is the same stuff over and over again. Well, this is these songs, and assuming that they, you know, if they were to do an album, assuming they would throw in a couple of unreleased tracks, which would be interesting. But this is something that hasn't been done before. So, I mean, I think it's a good thing. And not only that, what you said about the flow, playing the songs back to back, it's great the way they did that. It's almost like some radio programmer did it. You didn't have anything to do with this, right?
No, but, you know, I've been doing radio programs on the Beatles now since 1982, where I mixed the group and the solo together, and
mm-hmm.
to me, it's like one long, continuous body of work, and it all flows. I don't really separate the two. To me, it's just, like I said, one long, continuous body of work. But, you know, for the longest time, you know, there's a part of me that thinks of the Beatles as, you know, together, the greatest group of all time, and then I'm
mm-hmm.
proud of the fact that I'm so supportive of each of the four of them as individuals. But then you're grouping the four of their solo works together, and you're packaging it as if it's a Beatles album. And there are a lot of fans who have done something like this through the years.
Mm-hmm.
They put together their own collections, like this is 1970, you know,
right.
something from each of the four of them from that year, and 1971.
Sure.
These are four randomly picked cuts from different years. Hey, why not? Is a fairly new album with Walk With You on it. So, you know, I like the idea that this could give exposure to young people or even older people who have never really explored the solo music before. And, hey, it's free. What's there to lose?
Right.
So you're going to get a chance to hear four songs here for free. Download it. It can go to your computer or wherever you want it to go. And that alone is a good thing. But is it a good thing to package the four solo Beatles together as if they only have an identity as Beatles?
Now, that's an interesting thought. I think, you know, obviously, I'm sure this is something that they debated themselves, knowing the way they look, you know, they deal with these Beatle issues, you know, the fact that they know every time something like this comes up, you know, somebody somewhere is going to say something. Not because you just said that. I'm just saying that, you know, Beatle things get torn apart and debated, and, you know, from every angle.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not surprising that somebody would think that way. But I would think that given the fact that the way they named it four, and, you know, they basically, this is not the Beatles as a group. This is the Beatles separately. And I don't think there's going to be any confusion, really. I don't think that's going to happen. They are using the Beatles identity. There's no doubt about that.
Mm-hmm.
But heck, every Beatles solo release uses the Beatles identity because that's what they were. So I don't see that's a big issue myself. Do you?
I don't know if I agree with what you just said. Every solo release uses the Beatles identity. When Paul and Ringo put out new albums, they try to promote those albums, and they either perform it live or they do interviews and they talk about it, and they're bombarded with Beatle questions, no doubt about it. And sometimes, especially as we've talked about, Paul in particular likes to use the Beatles sometimes to help his record sell.
Yeah, and one of the places they promote their albums is on the Beatles website. They all do.
Right. Yeah, that's true. But, you know, I see the good and the bad in this.
Mm-hmm.
I like the fact that for so many people, and look, the majority of people in the world who know the Beatles music basically know the group, and they know some of the solo stuff.
Right.
It's a very small percentage of fans like us that have listened to all the solo music and know it well. So for all the people out there who are not that knowledgeable about the solo music, what could be better than be offered some songs for free? So in that regard, I think it's a great idea. I just don't know if I like the idea of them being packaged together.
I don't think the confusion, I don't think there's any confusion. I think what it does, and it does, I think it does what they intended to do, is to showcase the talents of the four individual Beatles and not them as a group. You know, they're pushing their solo work. And I'm interested to see where this goes, you know, if they do something else at some point down the road. But I think it's a good move. I think it's about time, actually, that they do something like this. Because basically, when they've promoted solo stuff before, they've kind of, you know, it's kind of been an afterthought. It's like, oh, here's Paul's album, here's George's album, but now they're pushing all four of them at once, and they're telling people, hey, there are albums out there that you may not have discovered, you know, and they're giving you a taste of the four, you know, the four Beatles, and very good. I mean, they, as we were saying, they pick some very nice tracks.
Uh-huh.
So I think it's a good move.
The issue with me is not how good the songs are. The issue with me is how it's presented. And actually,
I understand.
You know,
I don't see, again, any confusion with the Beatles at all. None. I think anybody who looks at this will look at it as the Beatles as solo artists. And that's why they didn't call it the Beatles. They called it John, Paul, George, and Ringo.
Right.
For a reason. And so I don't see the confusion at all, not at all. So
okay,
do you still feel that way? I mean, come out of this and say again, you know, how you look at it.
I see the good and the bad in this.
Okay,
you know, I love the fact that it's being given for free to people that don't know the music.
Okay,
it's what could be better than that?
Well, I think the free part of it is really the lesser aspect. I think it's the promotion of the, I mean, obviously that's a big deal because, you know, it wouldn't get distributed nearly as much as it will, but I think it's the songs themselves and it's the careers themselves. It gives a new shines a new light on their solo careers, and I think that's a great thing.
Okay, well there's other ways of looking at it.
Okay.
I see your point of view, but at the same time, I just don't like having to use the association of the four of them together to sell
okay.
the record, although it's not really being sold, being presented this way.
Okay.
I wouldn't want the only reason why the solo music to sell in the future because they were in the Beatles or because they're packaged together. They
mm-hmm.
should sell by themselves individually.
Well, they have been since... You know,
I know that, but just saying,
right.
This has not been done before. This is something entirely new, and this really intrigues me, the fact that this was
okay.
done.
Okay.
So the other thing we were going to talk about has to deal with the George tributes.
It has to do more with solo stuff again. We're talking all solo stuff today. Somebody posted on Facebook, and I posted it, complaining about the fact that there were so many young artists involved in the George tribute, both this week's Conan O'Brien tribute and next week's the tribute concert in Los Angeles. And I go ahead, you go first on this one, Ken. I'll let you go first.
Well, I actually think that the way that the George tributes, and this applies to everything, all the tributes that have been done. The John tributes, the Concert for George, the Beatles tribute, the CBS special back in February. I like the fact that new artists are doing Beatles music because it just proves that the Beatles are relevant to artists of today. And I like the fact that overall you mix the veteran artists with the new artists. Although, that being said, and we both said this either on our last show or maybe it was two shows ago, I think the Concert for George was probably the greatest tribute show ever. And part of the reason for that is because all the artists who were in that show were artists that were important to George, who were very close to George, that meant something to him. So I think that concert carried so much more weight for that reason. But when you do see the new and the old mixed together, I think it sends a powerful statement that, you know, the Beatles are not just appealing to the people of the generation that grew up with them initially in the 60s. It's not just for the first generation of fans. It's for the people from the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, the last decade, and today. And when you present the Beatles that way, it just tells you that the Beatles are not just part of the past. They're an ongoing thing, and they influence artists from every decade and every genre of music. And I think that when you do something like the CBS special or what's being done in L.A. right now with George, you're getting Brian Wilson there mixed with members of The Killers. You're getting Norah Jones in there mixed with members of Spoon, you know, and that's a good thing. The only thing that I would complain about, and actually I think a few people commented about this after the CBS special, is that while I love the CBS special because, like I said, it mixed the old with the new, and I love seeing Jeff Lynne up there, love seeing Danny up there, and Joe Walsh and those people, you didn't really have the people, just a few people, from the 60s and from the British Invasion, the real heavyweights. There was nobody like a Mick Jagger there. There was nobody from The Who there. Somebody, especially with a deep Beatles connection, Eric Clapton, was not part of that.
Yeah.
A Rod Stewart, or even Elton John, who came on longer, the late 60s into the 70s. Even people like that, the real icons, you didn't have those people. And the 60s people, the British Invasion, the great groups of the 60s, the legendary ones, the iconic ones, they're not representing the Beatles. But I still love the mix of what I've seen, but I would like to see some of those other people in there. And I found it rather strange. When you think back to the CBS special, why wasn't Mick Jagger there or Keith Richards? Why wasn't Roger Daltrey or Pete Townsend there? People like that. Anyone, whether it's individually or the band. But at the same time, it's very important to have the older generation mixed with the new and people in between. And I like that approach. And that's what Yoko in particular has done very well with the Lennon tributes that have been done. The only time that it was done differently was the Concert for George, which, as I just said, I treasure that concert.
Right.
You know, but I do like that other approach. And I think that it's making a statement when you mix the old with the new together. So I like it for that reason.
Well, I have a slightly different opinion.
Okay.
I don't mind mixing the old and the new at all, as long as the versions are good. There have been some very good modern versions of Beatles songs. There have been some very bad modern versions of Beatles songs and solo songs, and one of them was Beck's Wawa. I thought that was terrible. I listened to it. I watched it. I tried to give it every, you know, all the room I could to like it. And he just rushed through it really didn't care about it.
Hmm.
On the other hand, Paul Simon's version of Here Comes the Sun was beautiful.
Right.
It was absolutely wonderful. And because he put a little bit, you know, I wouldn't want to call it respect. I don't know that that's the term. But it was just better, you know. It was just done. It was beautiful.
Right.
And that the same thing goes for the, you know, the Night That Changed America. There were some really nice versions of Beatles songs. There were some ones that, you know, that I could kind of go, oh, okay, you know. And I mean, there's been a lot of Beatles songs done by other people. I mean, I'm thinking of the Glee, which I actually have not heard, but I've heard enough Glee to know that I'm probably going to sit there and cringe if I watch it or if I listen to it. I did try and sit through Across the Universe, and I've yet to get through that.
Really?
I can think of some really good Beatle tributes, All This in World War II, which unfortunately is not on CD at the moment. But that's a great Beatle tribute if you sit and listen to that. Even if it has all the strings and everything, it's still, you know, done really well. Of course, that's what you would call old because it's a couple of decades old, but still. You know, but I think the dividing line has to be whether it's good or bad. If somebody does a really good version, I don't mind it. If it's a bad version, and a bad version can be done by somebody old, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that's the dividing line. And in the case of Conan, so far you've had one really good and one really bad. So
okay, well, that's your opinion there. The mm-hmm. thing about this is that it's all subjective anyway.
Right. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
So, you know, you could have, like you said, you can have older artists doing bad versions. There are some cover versions of Beatles songs that I love that some people don't care for. So,
and there are some that are particularly bad that are actually fun to listen to. The Kathy Barbarian operetta versions from the 60s are hilarious, but they're fun. They're fun to hear. The can't remember his first name, Van Dyke. Organ versions that sound like Toccata and Fugue in D minor sound like E Power Biggs does the Beatles. Those are hilarious, but they're also fun to listen to.
Uh-huh.
You know, there's some great cover versions and there's some not so great. But in the case of, you know, who should do it, young versus old, obviously, you know, the question is, I mean, who does it well? That's really the case. And some people do it good and some people don't. I wouldn't divide the tribute next week, for example, saying all the older people do good and everybody else isn't going to do that because you never know what's going to come out of some of those talented groups. They may find a new twist in doing those Beatles songs that, you know, that nobody had tried before.
Mm-hmm.
And that's always a good thing. That's always a good thing. But I understand where he came from when he said, you know, all these younger groups, it'd be fine if they were all like Beck and didn't care. That's one, you know, that's probably a good point, but that's not really the case. There are some young Beatle cuts. I mean, that CBS special did have some good Beatle cuts. And by the way, if anybody from Apple is listening, please release that thing on DVD. Please.
You have a tendency, Steve, to say something as though it's fact. You know, when you talk about Beck as though he didn't care, you don't know if he cared or not.
Well, I mean, the way he tossed that thing off, it just would seem to me that he did not. And I think anybody that watched that would have to agree. I'm being critical, you know, that's what I am.
Right.
But I do think he kind of tossed it off a little bit.
Okay. Well, for the most part, I agree with just about everything you said. There's a lot of new artists out there that can give you very interesting arrangements of Beatles songs. And going back to the CBS special, I liked Imagine Dragons. They did a nice version of Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the veterans, I thought when the Eurythmics did Fool on the Hill, I thought that was brilliant, that particular performance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's all kinds of things. I wasn't crazy about some of the new artists, and that's bound to happen. But I also think that Beatle fans, so many of them, have such high standards. And there are a lot of Beatle fans that don't even care about covers at all.
Right.
How can they compare to the originals? And I understand that point of view totally. You know, how can anything compete to the Beatles' arrangements of their own songs? But then there are some people who feel otherwise.
I don't so much get into it anymore only because I don't really have time to go looking for them. But I got into covers a long time ago. And there are some great covers out there. One that comes to mind is Tomorrow Never Knows by Monsoon. Are you familiar with that one?
Not that one, no.
Look that one up on the internet. It's on YouTube. It starts out with a tabla, I believe it is, and it's gorgeous. Every time I hear that thing, it just amazes me how good that is. Anybody that hasn't heard that one, I suggest you go looking for it on YouTube. It's wonderful. It's really one of my top five, I think, in terms of Beatle covers. And yeah. I've heard a lot of them, and this has been out for many years.
Well, in general, I tend to like different arrangements of Beatles songs, but I think we're drifting off the subject here between Beatle covers and
sure.
Beatle tributes. They're two really different things. If you talk about the music of All This and World War II, I don't know if I'd call that a tribute. You know, they're cover versions of Beatles songs set to a movie.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if the artists who recorded those versions were thinking, hey, I'm doing this as a tribute.
True. That's possibly true.
It's a different approach altogether. But here we're talking about performances, live performances.
Right.
So, you know, I can certainly understand the point of view of wanting someone from that generation closely associated with the Beatles to have someone like that represented at these shows. Definitely Brian Wilson. Hey, come on. You know, he was such a great part of the 60s, that great Beach Boys catalog, and what followed as well.
Right.
But as far as the British invasion, you don't see any of those people there. Yeah, it would have been nice. I mean, I know that they're not marquee names today, but the people who were associated with the Beatles, that the Beatles helped, the Billy J. Kramer, Jerry Marsden, people like that, you don't see them at these Beatle tribute concerts. They're not asked to be, you know, and that's really a shame.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, I do agree with that point of view, but at the same time, I like hearing a mixture of both the old and the new. But like you said, Steve, it really comes down to whether it's done well or not. There are some people who don't like different arrangements of Beatles songs. They
right.
want you to
no,
keep
that's
it.
Very, that's very true also. Yeah. There are some people that are very traditional and, you know, that's absolutely true.
I like artists who have a style of their own and they put their own stamp on it. And
right.
My favorite Beatle cover is Earth, Wind, and Fire's Got to Get You Into My Life. It was their own arrangement of the song. They put their own spin on it. You know, and, you know, they made the song their own. The Beatles version obviously is a classic. I will always cherish that one. And I love Earth, Wind, and Fire's version, too. I love what Stevie Wonder did with We Can Work It Out. You know, I love there's a lot of Beatle covers that I like, but I tend to like the ones where artists put more of themselves in instead of trying to copy the original. So, you know, when it comes to these tributes, I'm all for them. And I love seeing tributes to any of the Beatles individually or as a group, and I like seeing a mixture of different people from different eras. Because, like I said, I think that's a very powerful statement right there.
Mm-hmm.
It means that the Beatles are not just a nostalgia act, you know, appealing to the people of their generation when they first came out.
Well, that's absolutely true. I mean, they live on. It's amazing.
Yeah, if you go back to the ones that Yoko did for John, I remember the one in Liverpool in 1990. I loved that concert.
Mm-hmm.
You have veterans at the time. Hall & Oates were veteran. That was a veteran act then. You know, you had Lenny Kravitz, who was newer then, and he was amazing at that concert doing Cold Turkey. I like when you mix the old and the new. And Yoko, I think, is very much aware of that, and not just in the concerts, but when there are compilations that get put together, like the Campaign for Darfur. You had a lot of newer artists of that time covering John's music, mixed with U2. You know, it's that approach, and I think that's very smart.
Getting back to the iTunes download, it just so happens that within the past 15 minutes, I got an email from iTunes advertising this. But what's interesting is at the bottom it says, check out their brand new pages on iTunes. So this is basically to call people's attention to the solo careers. This really has marginally to do with the Beatles. It's they're pushing the solo. They're looking for a way to market solo careers. And it's probably a good idea. So.
All right. Well, there's two sides to every coin. So hopefully we explain both sides here on the show.
Yep.
So.
Yep, and we actually did it without, you know, screaming at each other.
We never scream at each other.
I know. We need to do that. You know, some of those cable news opinion shows. People love that.
I think if we ever really had a knockdown fist fight.
Uh-oh.
You know, or I mean verbally.
Yeah.
That would be news.
That would be news. Yeah. Oh, well. Anyway.
So if you would like to comment on this show or get in touch with us, we have our own email address, which is thingswesaidtodayradioshow@gmail.com. If you want to get in touch with Steve individually, how mm-hmm. can people do that, Steve?
You can. Yes, they do. You can write to me at beatlesexaminer@gmail.com. You can also check me out on Facebook under my name and under Beatles Examiner. I'm on Twitter under my name and Beatles Examiner. I'm too many places, probably. My arms are stretching. That's how many places I'm trying to touch.
Okay.
But anyway, please get in touch about the show, about the writing, about anything. You know, if you have even a question that's unrelated to that, need an answer, I'll try to get it for you.
Okay, and if anyone wants to get in touch with me directly, you can write to me at everylittlething@att.net. And by all means, please check out my website, which is kenmichaelsradio.com. And on the website, it's packed with so many different things, interviews that you can listen to with people connected to the Beatles, especially a lot of Beatle authors, some of the same ones that you hear on this show. So if you haven't gotten enough yet of Dennis Ahlstrand, or Luca Parassi, or Dave Morrell, or any of the people that we've interviewed recently, there's another interview you can check out on my website. And in addition to that, you can find Beatles trivia every single week, and I give away prizes all the time, your choice of one of three prizes. And I have special contests that get run every now and then, some unique item, and often it's a CD or a DVD or a book that's signed by the artist. So, again, that's at kenmichaelsradio.com. You could also friend me on Facebook at Ken Michaels and listen to my own radio show, Every Little Thing, which is on WNHU live Wednesday nights from 8 to 10 Eastern at WNHU.net. Okay?
There you go.
I think that covers everything.
Yeah. I mean, I could obviously say check me out on examiner.com. I have multiple columns. Four columns about the Beatles, including the Beatles Examiner. I write about the Monkees, Weird Al Yankovic, and vintage rock and roll, and TV on DVD. So check me out anyway.
Oh, by the way, the syndicated version of Every Little Thing is also heard. Wait a minute, I'm tying this together. It's heard with our show, Things We Said Today, on fab4radio.com.
That's right.
They're bundled.
And thank you, fab4radio.com, for running the show on Saturdays and Sundays.
Yeah.
In fact, they run the first airing of the show is at noon on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
So there you go.
Yeah, but check out all the great programming on fab4radio.com.
Yep.
Yes, thanks to Matt at the station there for running both shows. See how I bundle them together?
Yes, I saw that.
Okay.
I do see that. Yep.
And also, since we don't thank him enough, thanks to Michael Lynch for coming up with the theme for us.
Yes, definitely thank you to Michael Lynch.
All right, so this has been fun. Thanks to all of you for listening. I'm Ken Michaels for Things We Said Today, and I'll see you next time.
And this is Steve Marinucci for Things We Said Today, who will be listening to his EP, free EP from iTunes, and we'll see you next time.